that you probably found yourself some more somewhere. But I do not really care, cause there's not.
This is familiar to you. Imagine yourself sitting in a cinema or at home and you just watch the movie. And after the movie, you're just sitting there like, can this be real? Could this be real? For me personally, The Matrix, Inception, some other movies you think of? Memento. Her. Star Wars, nice. All right, we're getting into that. It's perfect. Okay, you get the message. And sometimes that happens with a book as well. And in the last few days, I was spending some time on reading a particular book, which is central of this evening. I will show you the Dutch version. You might have seen this cover already. Title in Dutch, I'll say, Waarom de superrijken de wereld niet zullen veranderen. And we will get in length about that and... Is it real? Can we change it? We will touch upon both of these questions. Warm welcome. My name is Peter Mieles, and I'll try to do my best to host this evening and make sure that we also get some time at the bar downstairs later tonight. Just to get a feeling of who is here, who are we with together in this room. Who has read the book already? A few. Okay. To give you a brief insight, in his book, he explains different characters, different roles that people can take in the system. So let's explore a little bit what role is relevant to you. And you can raise your hand in different roles because we can all wear different masks, right, in life. So I will just name a few. And if it resonates with you, just raise your hand. It doesn't have to be entirely right. Doesn't matter. But just raise your hand whether you connect with that phrase. So first, government. Few, three, four. Just, what's your name and what's your connection to government?
I'm working there. My name is Judith Mulder.
Judith, welcome. You're working. Perfect. In government. Activist. Few hands. Yeah. Few hands. Just keep them up for a minute so we can see. It's about 10, 12. Yeah. Your hand was up as well?
Yeah, kind of. Yeah. I work at the Party for the Animals, so I feel like an activist, yeah.
Your name?
Lotte.
Lotte, welcome. Philanthropy. Yeah. Someone is waving there at the back. Yeah, sort of. I see here a more, this is a more visible hand. What's your name and what do you do there?
If I work in that field.
Could be.
I thought if I had a connection to it. No, I used to work with George Soros, so and I met him a couple of times and I was very inspired by meeting him.
And your name?
Jan Willem.
Jan Willem. George Soros is also in the book. We might touch upon that later. The business world. Not so many. Your business world, yeah?
Yeah. Impact Investment Consultant.
Impact. Ooh, that's a special one. Impact Investment Consultant. We might get to that later. Nice. And your name?
Bruno.
Bruno. Education. That is. All of them a bit. What's your name?
Herman.
And what do you do there?
I support organizations that try to promote sustainability and projects in education.
Do you work in a foundation, could you call it like that?
No, I'm self-employed.
Okay, welcome. And last but certainly not least, social entrepreneur. Few hands, just a little bit. Social entrepreneur?
Yeah.
Relevant? Yeah, that's a good coincidence. Just stay here for a second, yeah. What's your name?
Tom.
Tom van der Beek is the person who actually got Anand Giridharadas to the Netherlands. That's right, right?
Yeah.
Why?
The question why? Well, for me it was very simple. You know, the world is going to shit, basically. And we all want to do something about it, right? So we all try our best and, you know, start a social startup or do something with sustainability, and we hope it has some effect. But what if we do the wrong thing? Mm. What if we're really trying hard, but it doesn't really make a difference, or it makes some difference, but not the difference that is needed. So for me, that has been a question for a long time. And
like a personal quest, am I doing the right thing?
Am I doing the right thing? But not me alone, but, you know, other people as well. Mm-hmm. And when I read Anand's book, it was like he had the words that I didn't have, you know? But it really described well what I felt for a long time. Basically, that what we are doing, most of us are doing, is trying to make the current system a little bit more just or a little bit more green, mm-hmm. Without really addressing the underlying causes.
And that's what Anand.
And he really described it very well in his book.
Perfect.
So that was the reason why I was like, well, this guy has to come to Holland.
And he's here. Thanks for doing that. Thanks. The setup of the evening will be in three parts. First part will be, let's say, an interview setting with Anand about the book. Let's say half an hour or so. After or during the interview, see a little bit how it goes. There will definitely be more than enough room for questions from your side as well. So really, you will have the opportunity. And second part is on, let's say, the local situation of Extinction Rebellion. They will share, let's say, what happened last week and also the broader picture with us here. After that, second part. And then the third part, we'll move to, let's say, possible solutions, how to move forward. So in the first part, the interview with Anand, we will mainly stick to, let's say, the problem, what's happening around us, what is the system we're in right now. And then in the third part, we will move to how can we move forward with a panel here. You see four chairs, so it means four persons. Nice, simple. End time, is it relevant? Do you know when we end? 10 to 10, roughly. We'll see what happens. But I'll make sure that you make it 10 to 10. Easy to remember. Okay. I shared the mask thing already, a little bit different characters we can each all play, and sometimes you have more than one role. And this man, the writer of this book, played several roles in his life, and he probably still plays different roles in his life together. He is a former McKinsey consultant. He is also a journalist, a former New York Times and also Time Magazine. He's a Henry Crown Fellow at the Aspen Institute. Yeah, that sounds fancy. Is quite fancy as well, I suppose. He's a critical thinker, writer, but you could also refer to him as a thought leader. He did two TED Talks on the main stage, important to mention as well. And he's a husband and a father of two, various roles. And I'm really happy that Tom got him here in the Netherlands and we can go in depth with him about this topic, about his book, Anand Giridharadas. Yeah, what should we do? Do you want to take a seat or? Yeah?
Bar stools without bar.
Yeah, we could do so. Do you want some water?
I'm okay.
You're okay? Okay. If you change your mind, there is water.
I need the microphone.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah. I think you've been talking more than I will be, so yeah.
Good evening. Is that a disco ball? What is happening here?
Yeah, should we move a little bit forward? Yeah, then we don't see the disco ball anymore. Did you party a little bit in Holland while being here?
Not at all. I am working with an amazing team at my publisher who thinks it's appropriate to schedule me for 46 things every day. I don't often check my emails very deeply, so I sort of generally got the impression that this was a trip to Amsterdam, not a trip to like all the cities of the Netherlands in 2 days, which it turned out to be.
Quite intense.
Yeah. So it's been great though.
How's the energy level at the moment?
Fantastic.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's good. Is there a highlight, let's say, something that amazed you during these last 46 hours in the Netherlands?
Yes. And it happened a couple hours ago. I don't know what you all think of your parliament, but I'm going to tell you what I think of your parliament, which I just visited for the first time. I just had the most, the parliament's now dialing in on someone's phone. I had the most amazing experience. In some ways, the anchoring part of the trip here, we were trying to figure out when to do this, and Tom and Miriam managed to cook up this invitation to the Dutch parliament to testify about the book. And I was kind of like, what do you mean testify about a book? In America, when you're testifying, it means like you might be going to jail.
Yeah.
So I was like, what do you mean testify about a book? And then they said, you know, here's a whole list of authors that they've had testify before the Dutch parliament. Like, they just like to learn stuff.
And it's an interesting list.
Yeah.
Piketty, Kate Raworth, to name a few. Dalai Lama. That's a nice line to be in, isn't it?
He's a great author. And so I'm thinking, and again, you have to understand, I'm American, so I'm thinking, okay, so you're telling me there's a legislative body that is interested in learning for its own sake to maybe become better at its job. That's quite interesting. Never heard of that before. So I was still skeptical until I got there today. For the last couple of months, I was thinking, you know, they're probably going to cancel at the last minute, or they're just going to ghost me. I'll show up there, and there's no one in the room. Or
what happened there?
So I get there today. There's people from six different parties who show up, right and left, and an animal party. I'm not sure where the animals fall on the spectrum. I figure the left, but you never know. I like that guy. I really like that guy. And they've all received the book in advance. It's like a book club. Your parliament's like a book club. They've all received the book in advance.
And they
several of them seem to have read it. Several of them are like, when you say, like, okay. Which is like more than many journalists who've interviewed me in the past seem to have done in preparation. And what was, there's one word that defines my experience of this hour and a half encounter, is the word curiosity. They were curious. They were not there to score points with each other. Maybe they do that in other times. Maybe they do that on Twitter. But they were not in that room for 90 minutes. It was on television. But they were not there to score points. They were not jabbing. They were not using me as a punching bag, although they could have. Like, they were all there to learn. And the right-wing people had their curiosities, and left-wing people had different curiosities. But like, everybody was there to try to learn things they didn't know. And it was the weirdest, most disorienting experience for an American. Like, there are some people who have questions left in them. Mm-hmm. And these seem to be people with questions in them. And you're so lucky when you meet people who still have questions in them. And it was just amazing and interesting experience. And I told them what an honor it was to be in The Hague, which is not only the past home of my wife, but the future home of Donald Trump.
You're sure on that? Could be nice.
It's a nice town.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Great bars. Think about it.
Yeah. Let's get into the content of your book. Before we do the content, why did you choose to write it?
You know, I think for me, and it may be similar or different for you if you do this kind of creative work of any kind, I often find that there's things that are like minor, low-level irritations in me that and many of them just stay that way and you'd go on, but certain minor irritations, intellectual irritations, psychological irritations, irritations about what you see in your society, some of them get elevated to questions, curiosity, and then some of them get elevated to reporting projects, And some of them go all the way to trying to answer your own questions. And this is one of those. The irritation was the following. I observed all around me, and I don't think this would be alien to anybody in this room, that everywhere you looked, rich and powerful people were bending over backwards to change the world. Mm-hmm. Right? The richer you were, the more of an apparent revolutionary you were. Right? Silicon Valley monopolists, changing the world, empowering this, empowering that. Every Wall Street bank, find me a Wall Street bank that does not have some, you know, CSR project to empower girls. I mean, forget that you may have impoverished those girls' mother in the financial crisis, but you want to empower those girls. You're serious about it. Young graduates everywhere trying to do social enterprises, impact investment funds, some of the things you mentioned. And all this stuff is real. Those malaria nets that Bill Gates bought are real. All this activity, this amazing fluorescence of activity, activity that I would go so far as to say makes this present elite, plutocratic elite in the world, one of the most socially concerned elites in the history of the world.
It sounds good.
I actually don't think you had many elites in history where the people at the top really spent as much time and energy thinking about how do we fix this micro disease in this country and really devoted billions of dollars in time and energy. It's an amazing thing. And yet, how is it that that same period with all that activity I just described that you know so well, basically everything that Bono is involved with, how is it that that same activity, and you know the other half of this because I've heard that Bono uses your country to avoid taxes, how is it that that same class of people, the very same class of people who are doing all that helpful stuff, the same institutions, the same banks, the same Silicon Valley companies, have essentially become monopolists of the future itself, right? Let's go beyond the term inequality, which is a gap, and that's an important thing. But this is a gap with real life. Norway has a gap, but Norway's gap does not do what I'm about to describe the gap does in my country and many other countries, which is it is a gap that is weaponized to make sure that the people on the top of that gap commandeer most of the benefits of change. So when innovation, which is the Latin word for new shit, reigns on our societies, right? And there's been, in all of our lifetimes in this room, no one here would complain that there hasn't been enough new shit invented in our lifetimes, right? We've lived in a wonderful era for new shit.
There's enough.
The internet, health stuff, on and on and on. Electric cars, which I've been driving in. And yet it is a remarkable fact about the world that when all that new stuff has fallen on our societies, many of our societies, including the one I'm from and wrote the book about, the very few have harvested almost all that rainwater, right? 49% of new income in America goes to the 1%. Imagine in this room, a bunch of food arrived in this room, mm-hmm. right? And like one or two people took half the food. What would happen in this room? People would start to die, right? Like, people would start to kill each other in this room. But somehow you make it millions of people, and you make it money rather than food, some more abstract instrument, and we're cool with it. 0.1% of people in America now own more wealth than the bottom 80% combined. Just think about it. It's a number, but just think about what that actually means. Think about the room again. Think about what that means in this room. This room is too few people to even, like, do that math. You need 1,000 people in this room to just start understanding that math. And so the question then becomes, what's the relationship between all of the helping, which I am not denying exists, and I'm not denying does some good for the people that it does good for. Impact investment funds are real, and there are people, I have met some of those people, who are lifted out of poverty by it, right? Same with social enterprise, same with philanthropy, and on and on and on. Those malaria nets do go over real people's bodies, and that is good. Mm-hmm. But what's the relationship between all of that activity and the fact that the same class of people, and often the same people.
Can you share a little bit about that relationship?
So the default assumption out there in the society that I found, that I in a way tried to write the book to challenge, the default assumption is that the relationship is one of a drop in the bucket. that yes, we do have all these problems, and yes, these people are helping, and they're genuinely helping, and they're getting there. But if only more billionaires were as generous as Bill Gates, if only Chinese billionaires started giving at the same rates that American billionaires do, if only, you know, billionaires figured out how to be smarter about their investments in charity so that their dollars went further. If only we had more of Mark Zuckerbergs than we do now, things would be better, which is a remarkable theory. And I became curious about a different possibility, which is that not that these people are, you know, pushing, almost there, but not quite getting there, but in fact, that all of the extraordinary elite generosity of our time, which is real, is part of how we uphold, is part of the scaffolding of a system that is defined by extraordinary elite hoarding, and that frankly impoverishes, dooms, traps, and frankly kills people on a much vaster scale than all that do-gooding. And I'm giving you the straight dope opinion version now, but I am a reporter, and I, 4 years ago when I had this curiosity, I went on a journey of reporting, and I decided to spend time among these elite do-gooders to see what was true.
And so you know them as well. You know their circles. You know the people.
Well, I got to know them. Mm-hmm. And I spent time at the head of the Ford Foundation. So each of the chapters in the book generally is about one person or maybe a couple people. Head of the Ford Foundation, a young woman who's idealistic in college, senior year of Georgetown, wants to change the world, fight the powers that be, and like so many young people in America with that kind of thing, ends up at Goldman Sachs and then McKinsey. And it traces her decision. And by the way, she is about to leave McKinsey when she gets a phone call. She realizes it's a fraud. She's been conned, the way I realize that. And she gets a phone call that then makes her doubt everything, which is that Barack Obama's about to leave office, and he's creating a foundation to fix democracy, and he's chosen as his advisor for this project, McKinsey. And we'd like you to work on this project. And she's like, but this is a fraud. But Barack Obama wants me to do it. But Barack Obama's being misled. Why would Barack Obama hire McKinsey to help fix democracy? But on the other hand, if he wants to hire us, why would I not want to do that? And she goes into this thing.
In your book, you frame that as market world. You say market world is a system in which everything is ruled by the market. So let's say the rules of McKinsey apply on everything, to put it simple.
I think that's true, but I would frame it a little broader, which is I think market world is a term that I coined to try to scoop together many different worlds that are not themselves automatically together, right? So the world of billionaires giving billions away is pretty different than the world of the college student I described who's got debt and not a lot of money and is trying to figure out what to do with her life, right? Those things are not automatically connected. And those things are different from the world of, you know, the thinkers who become thought leaders who do speak at places like TED and sometimes feel pressured into not saying critical things about power in order to keep being invited back. That's different from the first two things. But what I wanted to do with the term market world is scoop all of these disparate things into a common reality. I spent time with former President Bill Clinton for the book. That's a whole other thing, which is like former presidents now basically all aspire to become billionaires in America, including, to my honestly shock, Barack Obama. And
so they're all part of this market world system,
yes,
the including the thought leaders.
$250 million since leaving office. $250 million since leaving office.
He's a quarter on his way.
And that was the number was from some years ago, actually. And so, you know, the thing that links all these characters of market world, the young students who are trying to change the world, the billionaires, the former presidents, who used to believe in politics as a way you make change, which is why they became politicians, and now only believe that you kind of squeeze like corrupt mining magnates for malaria money as the way to change the world. And what they had in common was a religion that I call win-winism, or doing well by doing good-ism. And the religion basically is this, like many religions, an incredibly seductive offer. The seductive offer is, we have found a really cool new way or set of ways to empower, enrich the least among us, to fight for the poor, to fight inequality. And here's the cool new thing about this set of ways we found. It doesn't require the powerful to give up anything, to change anything. In fact, you don't even have to know it's happening. It's gonna happen just below your feet, and it'll just happen, right? And this pitch, before we deride it or before we critique it, you got to understand how damn seductive it is, right? I think if you came to the men in this room and told us the lie that we can empower women, and we found this cool new way to do it that actually doesn't require us to behave any differently, doesn't require us to look within, doesn't require us to have impunity from sexual harassment the way we currently do, doesn't require us to change power structures, I think a lot of these men in the room would be like, click. And that wouldn't be malice. That'd be like, all right, if you're sincere that we could do all that for women and at no cost, like, that sounds like a good price. I think if you told white people the same story about what they could do for black people and immigrants and others, I think white people would take that deal. White people are desperate to take that deal. But the problem with these deals are that they're lies. And when you are in specific situations where the problem afflicting the people down below is the presence on their neck of someone standing above them, there's no way to actually lift them up without stopping the person standing on their neck. And I believe, just as white supremacy is one of those situations, just as patriarchy is one of those situations, what you might call capital supremacy, the rule right now of a class of plutocrats who own money, is one of those situations. There is no way to fight for workers, to create more economic security for people, to restore social mobility, to fight inequality, without dealing with the fact that some people have too much power, and if they're not made to have less, and if you don't have a plan for how you plan to take some of their power away, you have no plan.
Why does everybody buy it? Why is it like that?
Because of the seduction, the promise of painlessness, right? You think about other eras in history. You think about the American Civil Rights Movement, when you had white people and black people and other people going in buses to the South, register people to vote. They're getting beaten, people getting shot, right? That's traditionally what that kind of change looks like and requires, mm-hmm. right? So that's expensive. Some people do that, but that's not easy, right? And that kind of cost eliminates most people from frankly wanting to be involved in change. Even people who silently clap for it, that's a lot. So you come on and you say, you know what? We have a new way of helping those same people. Tote bags. A dollar from every tote bag goes to Bono, and then Bono routes it through the Netherlands, and 70 cents goes to register voters in Mississippi. I mean, let's reverse the question. Who wouldn't prefer that, right? We are being promised. And just because it's a lie doesn't mean it's not seductive, and those of you who have been seduced by liars know what I'm talking about. There is a wonderful temptation in the idea that you can achieve what your parents might have achieved registering voters at great personal peril in the South. You can achieve that same thing by buying a different bag. And we've gotten sucked into it. And now we have cupcake companies that give back. And we have ice cream companies that give back. And we have tote bags that give back. And we have socks that give back. And we have a shoe. If you buy this shoe, someone's gonna get a shoe in some other country. I have been to a lot of countries. I've never actually seen that other pair of shoes being put on anybody's feet, right?
Another aspect of what you phrased in the beginning, as let's say the paradox, you say, on one hand, rich people are giving more away than any time in history before, perhaps, probably because there's more money than ever. And on the other side, they're collecting more money than ever. They're richer, the inequality is bigger than ever. Mm-hmm. In your book, you also refer to, let's say, the great barons, the robber barons, actually, you phrased to them. And that's the time, let's say, what is it, early 1900s, where there were also really rich people coming up. And then at that time, they also had this, let's say, backlash from society that they would raise up and like, what's going on here? You're too rich. And then they started to sprawl some money around. And in that period you describe in your book, people actually said, wait a minute, this is dirty money. Why is that not happening right now?
This is so interesting. You know, there's a fantastic political scientist at Stanford called Rob Reich, who's written a book called Just Giving that's just about, it's kind of a companion to the philanthropy part of my book. My book's about a few more aspects, but his is like an academic, smart, but very accessible
treatment of the philanthropy issue. And he has this, makes this very elegant point that, like, philanthropy, like a lot of other things, is an exertion of power. Right? People forget that. Right? The military is an exertion of power. Mm-hmm. Right? Government is an exertion of power, obviously. Employing people, exertion of power. But philanthropy, unlike all these other exertions of power, is an exertion of power we don't think of as an exertion of power, and we therefore don't regulate. Like, if you run a business, you know that your employment of people is a heavily regulated terrain in every country, even the United States, right? Because we understand it's an exertion of power, and we watch you like a hawk, yeah. Right? Same with the military, same with this and that, right? Think about how many people around the world are employed as watchdogs of the military. Mm-hmm. Human Rights Watch, in parliaments and Congress's oversight committees. A lot of people are just got there. Just because people may go into the military with noble ideals doesn't mean we just leave them to try whatever they might, right? We watch them. We watch them. We're skeptical. But we're not like that with things that are do-gooding. And so 100 years ago, you're exactly right, when this modern philanthropic tradition was really starting, because before you had charity, you had the many helping many, you had rich people helping poor people. But what you started to have 100 years ago was this modern phenomenon of people who had so much money, but who also had these new scientific managerial techniques of running businesses, that when they decided to give back and help, they were almost from the beginning operating at a quasi-governmental level, right? When a Rockefeller entered the scene and wanted to do something for women's rights or labor, whatever cause he might be interested in, he was immediately competing with, like, the budget of certainly several states and maybe the federal government on a given topic, right? And now we know that's, like, very common. So that was a new phenomenon. And what is so interesting then, a lost heritage, is that most people in the power establishment then thought this was a terrible idea, thought the giving back by these people was a terrible idea, right? For a couple reasons. That we should not necessarily adopt as our full truth, but we should remember. Number one, Theodore Roosevelt said about Rockefeller, no amount of money, no amount of generosity in spending this money can compensate for how it was made. Mm-hmm. Right? That's the concern about greenwashing, as someone said. Yep. Right? And to sharpen the concern a little bit, I think one version of the concern is, like, you did a bad thing in the past and now you're trying to, like, clean your legacy. I think the more interesting and dangerous thing, which is often happening, is you're still doing the harm. You're still in the game. Like, Zuckerberg is still in the game. So in that case, the greenwashing is not like trying to have a nice obituary. It is the lubricant in the engine of your continued harm doing. You are, you know, like the Sackler family with the opioids in America, the art donations, as Tish James, the Attorney General of New York, said in a complaint, the art donations allowed the murder stuff to go on, helped it go on. So that was one concern. The second concern was the anti-democratic concern, the concern about why are we voting about stuff if, aside from that process, rich people are allowed to decide what public education is like, or rich people are able to decide what our roads are like. Then why even bother with this other protocol of democracy? And there were others. What happened, as you rightly said, people are often like, what happened to that heritage of skepticism? Well, what happened was everybody got bought off. Everybody. Philanthropy is now $400 billion a year in the US, right? More than the budgets of most countries in the world. And name the institution that is not directly or indirectly a beneficiary. Which university hasn't gotten some? Which
too intertwined, you say.
Which public school in America doesn't receive philanthropy, right? Which TV show? Which news thing? So over time, you start spending hundreds of billions of dollars a year. I mean, what is now hundreds of billions a year? You know what? A lot of that Theodore Roosevelt objection goes back into the mouse hole. People suddenly start to be fine with it. And generally, our position went from what Rob Reich calls reflexive skepticism to reflexive gratitude. And we got to a point where in the last few years, and that's also what motivated the book, I would look at serious newspapers like the New York Times, where I used to write, and the New York Times is like hard-nosed about all kinds of people trying to do all kinds of stuff, unless you are a rich person with some scheme, right? And you think, like, there are actually senators out there who are legit trying to give healthcare to everybody, and you write about them like wide-eyed dreamers who have no, right? And then there's like some guy who started AOL in the 90s, and he and his wife have some random ass plan to like help some guy in West Virginia who may be in a state he never went to. And that is written about, like, you know, beautiful portrait, photograph, you know, in the near the fruit bowl in the kitchen, you know, and like Gene Case gets a new lease on life, you know, this whole stuff, right? And it's like, why is there this exception? If you say you're doing something good, you just don't get the same scrutiny. So I am not calling for like shutting down philanthropy or anything like that. I am calling for a restoration of the same critical thinking and spirit that we apply, frankly, to virtually every other exertion of power, because it is an exertion of power, and it is often an unaccountable, undeserved one, and one purchased with various forms of exploitation of the planet, of workers, or of the tax system.
Okay. Before I move to questions from you guys, just a you met Rutger Bregman in person today after having an online affair before.
Yesterday.
And I'm just curious to hear, because you seem quite on the same, let's say, page. He said on Davos, Texas, Texas, Texas. Everybody in the world more or less saw that phrase. You seem kind of on the same page with him. If you look at, let's say, the USA, and you probably talked about the Netherlands as well with him, can you share a little bit about the similarities and perhaps also the differences you see?
We did. We met yesterday. You know, in January or February, whenever all those people go up to that mountain, I decided to stay. I mean, I decided to stay home, and I was not invited, obviously. but I decided to stay home and haunt Davos from afar on Twitter while also like playing with my kids and making pizza. So I did that for a week. It was very interesting. And so I was online, and I start getting tagged by like 10 different people within 5 minutes, being like, you know, your blonde Dutch brother is on fire. And I was like, A, I don't have a blonde Dutch brother. But B, I'm sorry that anybody's on fire. That's super sad. And I was getting like multiple of these messages, and I was like, maybe I took one of those ancestry tests or something. Maybe I have a blonde Dutch brother, which would explain something. And it turns out that it was this taxes, taxes, taxes viral moment. And so yesterday it was nice to be able to tweet a picture of both of us and prove that we are not in fact the same guy. He's a very fascinating thinker. And I think one thing we actually share is an understanding that in this day and age, if you want to do serious writing and thinking, there's a kind of interesting paradox where you have to also be signal jamming like at the opposite end of the communication spectrum, and like Twitter and like stupid moments on TV. And you know, I think the more deep you want to go, the more shallow you got to be willing to play. And that's a very interesting and weird feature of today's media environment. I think it's not fair. I think it eliminates from contention a lot of serious voices that we should be listening to that we don't know how to listen to anymore. I think that's our loss. But I think something he and I share is like a willingness to play at both of those levels, because that's just where the world is now. And you see it among leaders who are able to captivate people. And it's something we, you know, I think about in common. About the Netherlands, you know, we talked about taxes, taxes, taxes. You know, and I was saying before I came here on Twitter, no one got my joke, but I said that I was looking forward to coming here and eating one of those double Irish with a Dutch sandwich. And where could I get a good one? You guys know what this is? So all these people were like, yeah, hi, I'm from Amsterdam. I don't know about that sandwich, but you can get an amazing ham sandwich at this thing. This is actually a traditional Dutch sandwich you can get in the south of town here. And I was like, guys, I'm not looking for like sandwich recommendations. I'm also on keto, so I can't eat sandwiches. But anyway, so once we got past that, he was telling me about other tax loopholes, CVBV, which is similar to a nightclub we had in New York, CBGB. And what was so interesting is we were just talking, and it suddenly occurred to me, I was trying to think about like, how does this issue become appealing to regular people in this country? Because the tax haven you have here It hurts other countries, hurts my country. But I don't think it really hurts most people here, and I don't think it really helps most people here. I think like there's 3,000 lawyers who probably work here because of it, you know, and there's some additional economic activity. But it's not like, it's not really of benefit or a cost to anybody, but it's really harming other places. What do you do about an issue like that? And so I was just thinking about, like, how do you frame this for people, in part for the parliament today, where I talked about it. And it suddenly occurred to me, like, this country is functioning because of this tax havens that you create, as an exporter of oligarchy. Right? You may or may not feel like you've prevented one from taking hold here. You've certainly done better than us in not having one. But you're exporting it to my country. Yeah. And I said to the parliament today, I was like, there are kids in my country who are not going to get health care today, specifically. They'll be sick and won't be able to get health care today because your country has created a shield for companies in my country to keep that money from children in my country. And given the long and proud egalitarian tradition of this country was egalitarian before it was cool. This country was a lot of things before it was cool. And the idea that a country with that heritage would be an exporter of plutocracy, would be an ally not of the American public, but of people like Donald Trump and his friends and people who essentially want tricks to pull away from the rest of the society, is kind of incompatible with the solidarity that I imagine most people here would actually want to be in with the American people or people elsewhere. And I'm sure we do have tax loopholes in America that screw you guys in some different way. I'm not saying it's one-sided. And we have to stop doing this to each other.
Let's wait with this part for, let's say, the end of the evening to get to, let's say, more the way forward. Questions from your side for Anant. At the back, I'll get to you. Your name and question.
I'm Leon Heinhuis. I'm a city council member here for a left-wing party in the city of Amsterdam.
Thank you for public service.
Yeah, I loved your book. I think it's a very strong critique of the winners, as you call them. But I couldn't help think about while I was reading it, apart from recognizing myself in some of the stories, I actually also considered or realized that I am myself a winner of the system that we have. I'm not a billionaire, but I'm still a winner of the system. And as a person, as an individual, I'm also still keeping this system alive. And then when I finished reading your book, I thought to myself, am I any better than the billionaires you critique? Because am I not doing the same thing myself as those billionaires I now realize are doing the wrong thing? Am I not doing the same?
Look, I don't know what you do in your private life, but it seems to me that if you're serving on the city council, you are, in fact, very different from a billionaire. I mean, your job is public service. So maybe you're being a little hard on yourself. I mean, you presumably could do other things that are more lucrative.
Wait, I got to you.
But I'm also not a saint. I do this, I would like to change the system, but I'm not a saint. I go shopping, I drink coffee from some country far away, and if I'm tired and I go to the supermarket, I don't even look if I'm buying the sort of, you know, the organic stuff. I just don't care what I grab and I eat. I'm not a saint. I'm keeping the system alive. I'm doing many things that are harmful. I'm actually adding benefit to those big companies that take too much of the world, but I'm supporting them in doing that. So am I then any different?
This is a great and important question, and I'm gonna, you know, I don't know if you'll be convinced by my answer, but you might be absolved by it. What you described, the fact that you feel that way, is to me the consequence of a brilliant marketing campaign by billionaires. Okay, the fact that you would compare buying a slightly wrong brand of something to owning 5 homes and texting senators to put loopholes into a tax code to exempt your chemical company from penalties for environmental abuses. The fact that you are even putting those in the same orbit is so wonderful for the billionaires. I mean, in America, we call this both-sidesism, right? I mean, it's like you're equating frankly, someone trying to navigate a shitty system that is architected by other people with being the architect of that system. So, yeah, can we all make some of these choices better? Of course. But there has been a concerted effort in our time to turn systemic abuses by the powerful into opportunities for personal virtue by everybody, okay? And this happens in every power structure throughout history, right? You bet those Brahmins came up with ways in India to make the untouchables have to, you know, try a little harder. Try a little harder to be less untouchable, right? So I'm not discouraging you from trying to live a little better. We're all trying to live a little better. I've had a lot of vegan meals while I'm here, so you guys are like, you know, just trying to get a little protein in this trip, but it's not happening. But I think it's actually dangerous to think we're going to recycle our way out of a problem that is, frankly, a handful of companies imperiling the planet.
Hell yeah.
You know, and it is a distraction. And it is very similar to a certain kind of politics that has infected every domain. Step outside the environment. Let's talk about corporate feminism versus like actual feminism, right? Like lean in is the same thing as your recycling anxiety, right? Like, so we're telling women that thousands of years of patriarchy was in fact a posture problem? Like if they if women had been reclining at a different angle all along, none of that shit would have happened. That's Sheryl Sandberg's pitch. Raise your hand more, ladies. You don't like oppression? Raise your hand more. It's the same thing. They're trying to blame you for what is being done to you. I wouldn't stand for it.
Thanks. Other questions? Your name and question?
It's just easier. My name's Eliza. I'm managing editor at The Correspondent, which is the English side of what Rutger works for.
I quoted your publication in Parliament today. I used it as my evidence about the tax haven thing.
God bless you. Thank you. May philanthropy come my way.
I think I ended that for you today.
I guess my question was really helped by the one before, which was, I think often about the question of framing. When I was, whatever, 20, I wanted to set up a social enterprise. I did set up a social enterprise. And thinking about how we are given, you know, the billionaires have the whole house and we're given one room, which then everybody fights over. And how do we shift the framing on that? And I think often about the liberals being particularly problematic, sort of like our liberal self-flagellation of the things we could be doing better, and then buying in to the sort of competitiveness about, are you eating organic? Are you recycling enough? Are you? And there is a mental frame that we need to shift, and a communications one. What does that start to look like in terms of how we start to, yeah, opt out of that system and recognize that actually all we're doing is, rather than changing the world, just giving ourselves new lifestyle options so we can compete with our neighbors still?
Yeah. Fascinating question. And thank you for your work in helping run this site. It's a very important thing. I think there often feels to me to be a missing word in a lot of these conversations, whether it's the environmental conversation, the feminist conversation we're talking, which is power, right? So what the city council member was describing was a way of looking at the environmental issue stripped of a power lens. What Sheryl Sandberg is doing is taking an issue that is defined by the abuse of power and trying to like re-look at that issue without power involved, right? And it's this ideology of like empowering people without having a power lens, and it's very bizarre. And so I think the new narrative that needs to happen politically is actually getting people excited about the project of taking power back from the plutocrats. And what's interesting, I mean, in today's parliamentary thing, maybe it's always like this here, or maybe not, but you know, there were right-wing people and left-wing people, and the right-wing people, from the questions and the 90-minute discussion we had, they maybe didn't have the same concerns that the left-wing people had, but they seemed to have quite a few concerns about plutocracy also, as they should. By the way, plutocracy offends a whole bunch of right-wing values also, just maybe different ones. If you love free markets, monopolies are not for you. if you love free markets, people only being in business because they paid someone in government is not your thing. That's Soviet. That's not capitalism. And so I think there's an opportunity for leaders to actually transcend the left-right stuff and tell a story about power versus not power. That is a story that might unite 80% of people. I don't think we have too many of those leaders yet. I think in a way in Trump we had an awful version of that. He did appeal to people on different sides of historic divides, but with this awful pitch that took a sprinkling of this anti-plutocracy thing and then diverted all the anger onto this make-believe Muslim Mexican rapist who apparently keeps coming to America. And I think we need the opposite of that politics, which is people. I think AOC in the United States is someone who has that capacity over a long term. Right now she represents a small area that is very liberal. I think if she, you know, runs for the Senate in New York in 2022, which is a possibility, or president one day, and has to appeal to different types of people, my prediction about her is she will be able to actually appeal to a lot of Republicans. It'll take her some rebranding, the way it does after you've been in one job to another. I could see her speaking to like old white guy farmers in Ohio about their relationship to power and hers in a way that actually makes them feel totally seen. And I think we need more people who are able to do that, because the reality is, although white guys in Ohio right now often feel that the mythical Muslim Mexican rapist is their biggest threat, they are actually screwed by the exact same shit that AOC's constituents are screwed by. And no one is able to tell them that story well.
And she will be able to, you're saying?
I think she has that talent in a way that very few people I've seen have.
I got the impression that we could fill numerous days with you here. But let's move to the last question before we move on to Extinction Rebellion. And if you have a pressing question, we'll also make sure that there is room for some more questions when we do the panel at the end, all right? Yeah? Yeah, it's always difficult to pick. What are the pressing questions right now, so we just know a little bit how many
you
questions?
Do like, why don't we do...
Short question, short answer.
Yeah, but let's do like a few questions, and one, and I'll try to give a general answer.
Yeah, okay,
does that
sure.
work? That way we hear people.
Just...
I was just wondering, as an ex-McKinsey consultant, if you're also going to go into implementation a little bit more and into solutions about how to take the power back from these plutocrats.
That's going to be covered in a panel. Let's just pause
Correct.
That for now. Yeah.
Can I just say one sentence about that?
No.
If you ever go to a doctor...
Is it a short sentence?
Yes. You ever go to the doctor and your leg is turning green and you can't see out of one eye, and the doctor's like, okay, here's some pills and let me cut you open. You should run, right? A lot of diagnosis is required before you actually prescribe.
Cool. And let's do the final question for you for now.
Okay. Well, my question ties in with the first question. I believe we are still part of the richest 10% in the world on a global level, right? So aren't we... in a way, like, in a slightly smaller level, also, we are the wealthy, and a lot of people believe like they don't see that, and they want to protect their economy, and they want to protect their own country before they realize they should share and open up. At least that's my conviction. So
can you move to the question?
Well, the question is. Still the same, aren't we also like billionaires that are trying to protect their own wealth?
I mean, I think it's the same as the last question. No, I mean, there's guilt at all levels of all kinds, right? But I'm trying to tell you about something very specific that the data bears out. That if you look at all the data on income capture, wealth capture, etc., like the graphs all go crazy after 1% and often after 0.1%.
Where do you go from not guilty?
If you are looking for a black and white line like that, you're going to be looking your whole life. That's not how it works. That's not how it works. This is complicated. But the data is very clear that when you start to get to a stratospheric level, in the 1%, but frankly, shavings of the 1% also, you start to see something that is qualitatively different than what is going on below that, right? That is not like, yeah, we're all like not buying the right paper towel brand or like, want our kid to go to a better school than other people's kids go to. Yes, everybody in the world does that. And that's sort of human nature. You can price that into the stock. I'm talking about something qualitatively different, which is rigging a system to benefit exclusively you and your friends. And I do not think it is productive to blur what someone like Jamie Dimon at JP Morgan Chase or Jeff Bezos or Donald Trump does with her not buying the right paper towel. I just think that those are not the same.
Let's leave it for now here. Cool. Thanks a lot, Anand. We'll get back to you. Thanks. All right, let's move on. Extinction Rebellion. Familiar to whom? Hands. That's good. All right, we get more into detail about that by the following two persons. Linda Moeland and Tim Polaschek. They're from XR, Extinction Rebellion, the Netherlands, and they will share something about Extinction Rebellion itself and also especially about last week. About, let's say, 7-8 minutes, including a movie, and then we'll have some questions if there are pressing questions from your side. I'll give the floor to you two guys. Yes.
Thank you. Thanks. And thanks, Anand. This was extremely interesting, what you were talking about. And I think I haven't read your book yet, but I'm definitely going to read it, for sure. I think what XR and you're saying is essentially the same thing, which is basically that the system doesn't work. I mean, we are in a democracy, and the contract we have with our government is based on a social contract. The state's authority is based on the fact that it's supposed to keep its citizens safe. Yet we are on a catastrophic climate breakdown tipping point, and our government keeps investing billions of euros in the fossil fuel industry. This in itself is strange. Maybe before we get into the details of Extinction Rebellion, I'll introduce myself. So my name is Linda, I'm 33 years old, I'm Dutch. I'm an accountant by trade, a CPA, so not a climate activist at all. And actually, I got involved in Extinction Rebellion 7 months ago. And the reason that I got involved was that I saw one of our climate scientists give a presentation about the science of where we are, where our planet stands, and the risks we face as a species, but also the risks we face as a country that's below sea level. And I was shocked at the urgency of the crisis and the tipping points that we're so close to, and the complete lack of communication by our government around the urgency and the things that need to happen. And I felt I really need to step into the space, because when XR in the Netherlands was started, it was actually started by a bunch of students and mostly climate scientists who decided not to pursue their career, but spent all their efforts on trying to mitigate for this crisis and grow the movement and demand system change. I don't think we have the time to go into the details of the climate crisis, but unfortunately, the climate crisis is only one leg of the problem that our planet faces. We also face an ecological crisis. We are in the midst of the sixth mass extinction event of our planet. And I think Tim can tell us a bit more about that.
Yeah, hi, so my name's Tim Polaschek. I work as an environmental consultant. By day, I used to work in the carbon markets in England. That's kind of where I lost the trust in making quick systems change. I've been a concerned citizen over the last 10 to 15 years with a slow build-up of hearing more and more about what's going on in the world. And, I mean, we can go into the climate crisis, the ecological breakdown, some of the facts. Yesterday there was a report about effects of pollution from agriculture, for example, that in Holland we have 4 times as much nitrogen runoff pollution per hectare than the European average, and it's not like a sort of downward spiral, it's Holland and then the next country. Since we've started talking, 60, 70 football pitches worth of rainforest have been cleared. And this is, as Linda said, more than just an ecological crisis, a climate crisis. What happens when we degrade our environment? What happens when we degrade people's livelihoods? What happens when we degrade those relationships between people? As Anand mentioned as well earlier, when we start fighting for food, when we start fighting for resources, civil unrest is the next step. Civil unrest, societal collapse. And you feel powerless. And what do you do? What do you do about it? I mean, we've done lots of things. We've signed accords, we've signed declarations, we've set up intergovernmental panels. More than 6,000 people come together every year at a conference of the parties somewhere exotic and do absolutely nothing. So what Extinction Rebellion tries to do is it takes a tried and tested method, something that's worked a lot in the past with the American Civil Rights Movement, with Gandhi against British colonialism as well. And it's very simple. It's when people get together as individuals. It's called non-violent civil disobedience. And it's very important that it's non-violent and peaceful, because the powers don't know what to do with that. And it's very important that it's collective and that people are involved in it and that people from all walks of life are involved in it. Young, old, poor, rich, everybody sees the reason for this. And it's also important that it causes some sort of economic harm, because nobody ever changed anything without pissing someone off. And so we'll just show you what a little version of that looks like here in Holland, what we managed to achieve a couple of weeks ago from the 7th of October, which is a really beautiful way of this coming together here in Holland.
Yeah, that was a long video.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. We now have the... We saw, let's say, a recap of the last weeks.
One week.
Can you get the that mic? Sorry. Yeah.
Yes. That was a recap of the first day.
The first day only.
Yes, that was a recap of Monday. Yeah.
Okay.
But and we were doing actions for about a week.
Could you call it a success from your both perspective?
Yes, I think so. I think what we must keep in mind is that when I joined XR, I think we were about 50 people, maybe.
And that
in
was
end of March 2019. And we grew exponentially, especially in the Netherlands, where I don't think we really have a protest culture. Mm-hmm. It's not France or the UK, where there's a much more ingrained suspicion, and except for the farmers, maybe. Yeah. Natural suspicion of government. Here we tend to have a lot of trust in our institutions. So I think even during the protest week, I think there were thousands of people who partook, but even people finding us at random locations, waiting to be given nonviolent direct action trainings, I think for us it really showed that there are lots of people who are deeply concerned about the environment and who know that the government isn't doing enough. And I think they were waiting for some sort of platform to appear, mm-hmm. or some movement to become a part of. And yeah, I think in that sense it's been very successful.
And I can imagine having this success that it will even...
Hopefully, yes. Yeah. Yes, I think our aim now is to grow the movement exponentially, mm-hmm. until the next rebellion. So the Extinction Rebellion method or tactic, as Tim explained, is one of nonviolent civil disobedience, mm-hmm. because history has proven that that's really the only way that you can manifest sustainable system change.
When's the next rebellion?
April. So you still have time to join.
Okay.
If you want. And what you see in the background, because maybe it's a bit random, you see our three demands. So our first demand is tell the truth. And I think this is the main demand that's most important for where we are as a country. And because I think a lot of people think they know about the climate crisis, mm-hmm. but actually we don't know all the details of the climate crisis. We don't know the urgency. We don't know the side effects. Everybody seems to think 70 years from now that we might have some issues with water, but what will happen in between is that we'll have crop failure, we'll have mass migration, political instability. All of that will happen before we have water issues.
So one, tell the truth.
Tell the truth, yes.
Second?
Become carbon neutral by 2025, which is based on the science. The science tells us that if we want to have a chance of mitigating the biggest risks around climate change and the wider ecological emergency, we need to become carbon neutral by 2025.
And is there a third one?
Yes. There's a third one, which refers to a citizens' assembly. So similar to the reasons that Anand explained, our democracy doesn't work due to the concentration of power in the corporate lobby. Mm-hmm. So what we suggest is that in order to actually establish carbon neutrality by 2025, we need to empower citizens more, because we believe our politicians won't be able to make the right choices due to many reasons, and therefore we want to make sure that citizens, as part of a citizens' assembly, mm-hmm. vote on climate policy.
All right, cool. Let's leave it for now here. A question about Extinction Rebellion for now, before we move to the panel. There, I get to you. Yes, your name and question.
Hi, my name's Leonie.
Hi.
And I have this strange paradox in how, in my head, Extinction Rebellion is framed. because yeah. The way you I'm leaning over here, so yeah, okay, thanks. Yeah, I will. Because the instrument you use, the pacifistic way, and you describe, I think, Gandhi and maybe Nelson Mandela, they all give me this warm, fuzzy feeling, these wise old men that take time, whereas when I hear about Extinction Rebellion, it's more aggression. It's more, we demand things. Do you see, do you experience this paradox yourself as well, or is this how the media envisions you, or why do I have
I think there's
paradox?
A lot of media framing. I think maybe also the name, that there's rebellion in there, but what we demand is a just transition to an inhabitable planet, so there's no aggression inherently in there. So I think there's a lot of framing.
And also, it's the first organization I've ever been in where you can take nonviolent communication courses. That's the first time I heard
it. It's a very empathetic organization, I think.
The atmosphere there was amazing. It was incredible to have lots of people from all walks of life come together for the same reason.
I think you should join in April to... Ah, all right, cool, perfect. Okay, we leave the questions for now. We're going to move to the panel. Yeah, thanks a lot. Linda, you will be joining the panel, so you can take a seat already over there. Tim, thanks a lot for now. Yeah, there's... The topic is just too interesting. I understand there's limited time. Sorry for that, but... there will be drinks afterwards as well, so hopefully we can compensate a little bit.
Yes.
Maybe if you move there so we can just fill it up after. Perfect, yeah. Okay. Cool. Let's move to the panel. What we're going to do, we'll have four persons here and discuss. Yeah, you're not the only one. And discuss, let's say, how to move forward. And to be frank on that, we don't expect to have the solution at the end of the evening, but let's explore it. First person I would like to ask here is, let's say, a real doer. She does stuff. And she's also the founder of TEDx Amsterdam Women. And she's a doer on, for example, the position of women and also the people of color. And she's also a board member of a foundation, the Van den Ende Foundation, so she probably has some insights about the world of foundations as well. Her name is Marianne Spier. Welcome, Marianne.
Thank you.
Let's start with the message from Anand. What does it do to you to hear his message?
That there is hope, that people are thinking about what is happening around the world, and that they are challenging certain systems. Because I've the things he was talking about, I see it. But I always think, like, how can you challenge it and how can you disrupt those systems? So that is always my way of trying to change things in the world.
Can you share a little bit about how you do that? How you try to change
things? How I try to change this. I will use a few examples. So, for instance, almost 10 years ago, I started with TEDx. I just use platforms that have a lot of media attention. And then I use those platforms to disrupt systems. So 10 years ago, I didn't know anything about women's issues. I've worked in tech for many years and then in education at the University of Applied Sciences in Amsterdam. But what I saw when I was watching television is there were hardly any women on television, like intelligent women, sorry. But like really, at the talk shows, there were always one sitting on the side and saying something weird, and then the guys would give intelligent answers. And I was like, I hate this, but how am I going to change this? I'm going to use this platform. So what I started doing is I started researching and looking for women, scientists, people, women who have done great stuff, live in the Netherlands, but mostly work in other parts of the world, and try to reshape the world. and are just doing their thing. They're not busy with the media, and I started giving them platforms. And what we saw in the first year, we had a cardiologist who was working, who was doing research on women's heart diseases for 7 years, and she told me the story. And what a lot of people didn't know is that in the Netherlands, there was no research on that. So when you would go to the doctor and you, a woman would have a heart attack, the doctor wouldn't know what your symptoms were because all the researches were based on men's.
Only men's stuff.
Yes. So when she started sharing that on the platform, on the TEDx platform, it exploded, and it immediately the government, even the queen, a lot of people started saying, like, we need to change this. We need to work on this. And now there's a lot of research on it, and it's almost every year in the news, and you have a red dress day and anything. And every year I try and look for topics that the media is not looking at because it's not interesting, but it is really important to women.
Cool.
So, yeah.
Let's leave it
for
now.
So okay.
You can have a platform to give important ideas more attention.
Yes.
Cool. Thanks a lot, Marjan. You'll join the panel.
Okay.
Take a seat. Get yourself some water. We move to the third person on the panel. He's living in Drenthe. He's not a farmer, but you might expect then, because he's now here, or maybe in The Hague earlier. But anyhow, he's a real expert on the purpose economy. And he's also in the worlds of philanthropy and investment. And he has a company called Purpose People Practice. And his name is Kees Klomp.
Hello.
Welcome, Kees. Same question actually as for Marjan just before. What does it do to you to hear Anand's message?
Well, it felt like a slap in the face or a kick in the butt, or it's very uneasy reading, which is
personally.
Which is fantastic, because I think that what it did for me, and Tom and I, you know, we had a couple of talks about it, is that it in my humble opinion, it shows a deep truth. And I think you can only change what you get, what you really acknowledge. And I think we're in this the depth of the shit that we're in, and that it helped me to acknowledge that. So very uneasy, but very useful.
Is it then an eye opener as well that you were not aware of it, or is it more, let's say, like Tom phrased it before, I couldn't put it in words myself?
Well, there were certain parts that I wasn't aware of as well. Mm. And, it basically showed me, we are a market world. You know, it's inescapable. Which is an interesting starting point to really change that system. Because if you don't know there is a thing called market world, then you're not able to change it as well.
Yeah, because you don't know what to fix.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
About the fixing, what is your, really briefly, what do you do?
Well, at this moment, what I try to do is I'm focusing on education now, because I think it starts over there. And what I try to do is I try to help schools with developing a broader value language, because I think the ultimate crisis that we face is not climate change or climate crisis, but the value crisis. I think that the problem is that we can only express value in monetary terms, in money, and I think that if we would be able to stretch that definition and make other things valuable, then maybe we can change stuff.
And do you get the money to get that into place for
millionaires? No, money is just money. And, if we can...
But you need money to do that stuff, or how does it work for you?
Yes, of course. That's why it's so uneasy. I'm part of the market world as well. Yes, yes.
Okay, cool. Take a seat. Yep. We'll get into that. And Anand, please join as well, and we'll get into it. Let's say we try to find, let's say, kind of like a guiding line into this conversation, because it's quite a challenge to let's say solve it on one end. Yeah, you can just give it to me. That's fine. Yeah.
Yes.
But we have a guiding question for this conversation, and the guiding question is basically to get some clarity about which way you head. On one hand, you have, let's say, a more extreme, you could call it, approach of really transform things. Really, this system needs to collapse before we can move forward to another system. And let's say the other side, where it's a more, let's say, a subtle approach, where you more reform things rather than transform. Just to get a brief feeling for all of your opinions, let's go briefly around through all of you. Let's say, on which side do you lean more towards? Are you extreme on, let's say, the transform side, the reform side, and briefly why you're on that side? Let's start with Anand here.
First of all, in terms of the two, I would add one element to the spectrum, which I think is actually the most common opinion right now, which is like tweaking, technocratic tweaking. I think that's kind of what actually people are saying. And then reform is one stronger than that, and transform is one stronger than that. But most people are still not even in either of those, which is the problem. On the fundamental issues we've talked about tonight, I'm a transformer.
You're a transformer. That's a good quote. Okay, let's move to Linda.
Yeah, I agree. I think we need to radically transform the way we think about value in our society, but we also need to radically transform and localize and make our economy more regenerative so that we can work within planetary boundaries. So yeah, transform.
Okay. Yeah, me too. And that's a scary thought.
Yeah, it's very uncomfortable.
Yes.
Why is it scary for you?
Well, because of the power thing. I mean, I think the current system is very much in power, and so to transform is not a it won't be friendly.
Marjan.
I agree. Also, I believe in transformation. Also, if you look at what is happening in the world in the news, if you look now at Barcelona, the Netherlands, the world is on fire almost. And if there will be no people, I think also people in power who will start trying to change these systems and transforming the systems, it will, I don't know what will happen in 10 years.
Can we explore the how a little bit then? Because if you all agree on, let's say we need transform, how?
Yes. I try to do it a little bit. I try, I observe, I work together with governments, and then I advise. A lot of times I tell people, especially in the Netherlands, I don't know for the US, but in the Netherlands you can advise the government on certain things and help transform systems. And what we see is that everybody, most of the time when I'm in several boards, is that people are just nodding and saying yes, 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 and then I say no, you know? And you should not be afraid to say no. You should not be afraid to go against what everybody is saying. These last 10 years, I've constantly been going against what everybody is saying. The first year I started with the women's thing, everybody was calling me crazy. Not one interviewer wanted to talk to us. Now everybody's talking about women's issues. It's the same with female entrepreneurship. It's the same with diversity and inclusion. So we can start now when everybody's going to talk, but there are other issues just like climate, which are not popular. But if you want to transform and you want to bring change and you have the power to do it, you should not sit and just nod.
Anand, I'm curious to hear what Marjan is also saying is that you're talking to governments, right? What I get from your book as well is that government and business, it's kind of the same. It's all market world, including governments. What is your view on that? Like, how to influence government to get transformation? Is that actually possible?
I do not think government and business are the same. I think government has been captured by business. Yeah. That's different. And you got to remember, we can afford for businesses to come and go, right? Governments, by definition, are us, representatives of us turned into this sovereign body. And they can be changed and replaced. And you can have a full government of people who agree with you. I mean, if we can make that happen. So you don't throw out the idea of government the way you throw out the idea of business, potentially.
I think the important question for me in terms of what do we do, there's a million little answers. But there is, to me, one big meta answer, which I think you captured very well, which is, I give you one word, joining. Joining. We have forgotten a heritage of joining in our time. And joining has been replaced by clicking. And I was talking about, in Parliament today, this book by Gia Tolentino called Trick Mirror, which you must read. It's one of the
best books I've read in a while. And she talks in depth about how these social media platforms simulate the emotional loop of feeling you have done something like protest when you haven't. Mm-hmm. And it's even more sinister in an age of plutocracy because you're basically spending all your time on the platforms owned by billionaires, volunteering free time and energy and attention. You're giving them your attention, which is a resource. They are monetizing it to sell advertising. They're making money, deepening plutocracy. And you are thinking you've done something like Extinction Rebellion, but you, in fact, have not. And then you don't join something like this because you feel you already did. We got to stop clicking and start joining shit. Like joining shit where we know the names of people, where we're like cooking with them in our house a couple times a week, where you know the names of their kids. Like actual joining.
Real joining.
Real joining.
Well, the good news is that if there is a lot of citizens' initiatives, so you have a lot of citizens. Initiatives like food cooperative, energy cooperatives, and they actually take a very interesting position because they, you know, they create, you could say, a sort of parallel reality. You know, they basically create their own shit. They do, they like citizens. So it's co-owned. All the money they make, you know, is shared as well, and there's a lot of, in my humble opinion, there's a lot of positivity and optimism in that, and it's rapidly growing.
It's also joining.
Yeah, very much. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Cool. Thanks. Wait.
Could be.
We will move to questions from your side because I feel that there's a lot of them probably. I will first move to you. I saw a hand there as well, and then explore how we can move forward. Your question was, isn't that tweaking?
Yes, there was no definition given of transformation. So, and the answers have some implicit definition of transformation. I'd like to hear what you think transformation actually is, because some of your answers I would not consider transformation, no. So maybe we should talk about that first.
Good point.
Were you asking me? Or sorry.
We believe in you.
Okay, thank you. Awesome. Well, what I view as transformation, I'm just talking from the perspective of protecting our livelihoods, right? So I'm not talking from the perspective of GDP growth or perpetual growth or any of those things that we've conditioned to believe are actually parallels to our own, you know, wealth as humans. I think we need to radically transform our economy, and we need to do so in a way that's different to our current democracy, because our current democracy just doesn't work. It's very short term, and especially in the context of the Netherlands, our government doesn't even listen to higher courts. If we look at the Urgenda example. So when I talk about transformation, I talk about the economy, but I also talk about bringing our democracy closer to the old Greek system, or a purely democratic system where randomly selected citizens who have no skin in the game, who are anonymous and cannot be found by the corporate lobby, who are heavily educated on issues around the planet or whatever it is that they're voting on, that they are more empowered so that we can actually ensure a just transition and make sure that whatever is decided upon as new policy to reach whatever goals we're trying to set are just and are representative of the people as opposed to the corporate lobby.
The rest of the panel, is there an addition to this explanation of transformation and what it could include from your side?
Yes. In my humble opinion, transformation means system value. Eh? So it's a serving economy rather than us serving the economy. So flip the system.
Yes.
Biosphere first, social sphere second, economy third.
Yeah.
That's it, transformation.
I think we forget sometimes that the economy is supposed to serve the people. But the way we sometimes look at our country, or the way our cabinet looks at our country, is almost like a stock market. Very short-term gain for a very small amount of people, and somehow we're okay with that.
And we need to transform that.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, to stick with the environmental thing, I'll tell you my taxonomy of the tweak, the reform, the transform. You know, I think the tweak is like, you should buy better paper towels. Right, the tweak is a tote bag that's going to donate to the rainforest. at a much slower rate than it's being destroyed. So we know what that is. I think reform is like something like a carbon tax, right? Which would be a really, really serious thing that some of the most serious people think would maybe be enough to slow this. But it's still in some ways with, you could still achieve that possibly within a system that is quite like this, that is a culture that is quite like this. I think we could, that's something that's achievable without what I would call transformation. I think transformation, I'll refer to a question someone, I think that maybe the Animal Party guy asked today, which is like, we have to shift from an egocentric culture that is behind this economy, which is a little bit what you got at, to an ecocentric one. That's to me means transformation, right? Which is not just like passing a particular tax, as good as that might be, but actually understanding that we have the problem you're fighting, we're all fighting, because we have a fucked up culture that tells us the wrong things are good and the wrong things are bad. And when you start saying, we're actually not gonna maybe fix this stuff until we rewire ourselves, until what makes us feel good is different, until the movies we watch are different, the books we, like, that's when you're talking about transformation. And that's why I think it's probably necessary to achieve some of the things you're talking about. What you're actually talking about is not just saving the planet, but a way of life gone wrong and the possibility of a different, better way of living.
Yeah, yep. Absolutely.
I have a question about that.
Let's move. You have a question about this. Then I move to you, because you've been having your hand up for a while already.
Mm-hmm.
After this question, I'll move to you in the back. What's your name? What's your question?
Hi, my name is Tineke. I'm a mother of three. And I just wonder, it sounds a little bit like me, like we're talking about Louis XIV. Like all those billionaires are like this person who was really estranged from the world. And isn't it necessary to go and to communicate with the billionaires to have like their people? And you should have the communication with them. I suppose they're intelligent people. Like if you have this value talk with them, because you can say we want to change the government, but as long as we have democracy and people vote for Trump, we won't advance, not in America. If they vote Boris Johnson, we won't advance. So maybe we should have the talk with Louis XIV himself.
I'm very happy you said that, because it's a great way for me to tell you that we have copies of the book outside for you. That's what I did. That was what I did.
I didn't read.
What I gave you today was my opinion at the end of that journey, but that is not what's in the book. The book is me going to talk to these people for 3 years.
You're gonna read the book.
Okay.
Yeah,
right?
You're gonna read the book.
And actually trying to have, you know, and I sat there and I had these arguments with them, and I did them the honor of arguing with them with a notebook and a tape recorder trying to understand. And, you know, I sat, for example, with the hour and 15-minute argument with Bill Clinton. Not argument, it was an interview, technically. And he said this thing, it's not about the environment, but it gets at a lot of the same things. We're talking about an issue that he worked on a lot. He had a heart attack, and he got interested in, you know, health stuff because of his own dieting, and he got interested in childhood obesity. He's from the South. In the South, we have, you know, all these problems with people drinking, like, Pepsi all day, and you got kids with diabetes, and it's terrible. Very common. And he gets involved in this issue. And the way he gets involved is the typical, like, tweak way, not even reform, right? I'm gonna work with the soft drink companies to make the cans smaller. And I was like, so I said to him, I was like, to me, this issue feels almost like invented in a philosophy seminar to justify aggressive government action. Why? You got kids. Kids can't vote. They can't file lawsuits, sort of like on the climate issue. They actually don't have a lot of the legal means of fighting the power of well-connected corporations that are using their power to get vending machines into public schools on government-owned land. Like, isn't this a paradigmatic case of the use of public power to protect a vulnerable population from well-connected corporations on your government's turf? And he says, well, a Democrat, it's always better if you can make things work in the private sector without having to bother the government. Because, you know, those companies still need a business model. If you're gonna take away one thing, you gotta help them make money a different way. And to me, it was just like, it's very easy to go after the Trumps and the Cokes and the, like, TV cartoon villains. But when the Bill Clintons think that way, when the people who know better think that way, we have lost a cultural argument about the use of government, about the use of public power to solve our biggest problems, and this wacko faith in the market. So I did talk to them, and I had conversations like that, and I encourage you to check them out.
Name and question.
Hi, my name is Karim Attic. I'm with Weave the Future. I'm considering deferring to the voices that are the women voices in the room. I'm considering deferring to other voices in the room that are usually not included. There's 10 men who have asked a question and one woman has asked a question. And I think this is part of it. We got to realize that this is all part of the system. This is the operating system we're being programmed with. It's an operating system of individuality, separation, disconnection. We're not all in this together. Because disconnection, staying on my phone so I'm not spending attention on the things that really matter. And this is really what we're talking about. We're all part of this, even though we can blame the billionaires because we're playing their rules. So my question is, I'm not going to defer to one of the women, but come on, women, you speak up.
There's always a twist.
My question is really, if we do think the systems are starting to collapse, the systems we're in now of consumerism, climate change is coming, authoritarianism on the rise. If we do believe these systems, these are all symptoms of the system collapsing, what is the system afterwards? And how are we shaping that together? Because you can count on big tech wanting to shape that. You can count on corporates wanting to shape that. You can count on the billionaires and the Chinese wanting to shape that, even if they have the best intentions, maybe. But how do we shape that story together, right? How do we really come together, include all the voices, and make a representative story together? That's my question. It's a big question, but
yeah. All right, I'll try to answer your question. I think a lot of what you said kind of comes back to taking back your power as a citizen, and also realizing that you have a responsibility, right, in establishing the society that you want to live in. And I think I'm just going to speak for myself, but I work in corporate finance, and I have worked in corporate finance for the last 13 years. And so I'm conditioned to think in patriarchy terms, right? Competition, the better, the less good you do, the better it is for me, et cetera, et cetera. The moment I joined Extinction Rebellion is the moment, actually, that I started feeding my more empathetic self and also interacting with people from different walks of life, which I probably would say it's almost a spiritual journey. It was also very practical and constructive in that we're trying to get all these people on the ground to protest with us. But it's definitely, something that we're not used to in the West. And I think that's also what makes the movement so powerful, because in essence, maybe the name sounds a bit full on and aggressive, but what it really is lots of people with kids and lots of scientists, accountants, economists, and lawyers and doctors standing there thinking, oh God, none of us really want to be here, but here we are. And it's very powerful to connect with people in that way, because everyone's scared, nobody wants to really be there, and you're standing there thinking, shit, we never do protests in the Netherlands, I hope they're not gonna have the riot police here, and then you see the riot police, and you're like, oh. So I think there's huge value in connecting with people offline and actually daring to take that step. And once you make that step, then you find there's so much power in having an informed and organized people. So I don't know if that was an answer to your question. It was an attempt.
I don't know if you want to add to that.
Well, I'll just share, because the question was really big. Well, everybody was talking. I was thinking about the first time I started with this whole feminism thing, and I spoke to a Tunisian lady, and she said, she lives in Lyon, and she said, my mother's feminism is not the feminism of her boss. Thank you. So we are, like, I meet a lot of activists and everybody who's trying to create a better world, but when I talk to people who cannot afford to go to Markt with a queue and say, you know, I need to buy the cheese. I cannot, you know, buy the organic cheese because I have 5 kids at home. How do I live more sustainable? So we're really focused on even this conversation on ourselves and our own situations. And I hear a lot of people talking about their own situations. but there is a larger group of people who cannot even afford the way we live. And I think we have to shift that focus. We have to think about these people because we have to bring them to a level where they will be able to live a sustainable life. And they don't have to go to Kentucky Fried Chicken because it's cheaper to eat there. And transforming the system starts, of course, we can, and it is very good to look at the plutocrats, but it's also good to look at ourselves. And I, in the beginning, I wasn't living like that because I was so focused on myself. I had a great job and I didn't. But when I started talking to people who said, I cannot live, I cannot buy sustainable fashion, I cannot go and, because when they come, they come to pick up my garbage, I cannot separate it. What are we doing about that? And I think my goal in life is to focus more on that, to bring the group that cannot afford it and cannot live the way we are living to have a better and more sustainable life.
Thanks. Let's just investigate. How many people have a pressing question before you can easily sleep tonight? Whoa, yeah. Very pressing.
Yes.
All right, let's just do some quick questions, quick answers. There can also be big questions, but then maybe a short answer of a direction. Let's move to you. Your name and question.
My name is Caroline. Just an idea. If you take the billionaires, their money, not the money for the philanthropy, but the money of their investments, and you would calculate how much they add to go over the 2 degrees of the Paris Accord, I think you get an extra story. Your two stories together. I mean,
it's one story.
If you not only look at their philanthropy part, but at the other part of their money, and see the damage that is done by the rest of the money, which leads, you know, not only by because I thought that the interesting thing was that you become less welcome socially. You know, you not only get changed by you only also get changed by the powers not being socially accepted anymore, right?
Can everybody hear a question? or comments? It was not a question, but...
It was a suggestion. It's okay.
Brief comment on it from someone who feels...
But I think you're right, they're the same issue. The point is philanthropy is just one very small piece of a big puzzle, which is rich people capturing things, causing this planetary crisis. And they're fighting on two fronts. They're destroying the opportunity structures within each country, and they're destroying the planet as a whole in case the opportunity structure thing doesn't work. But they're both driven by the same thing.
And can you do the numbers?
The numbers for a third... For
not right now, but like maybe later.
There's
give
a new
five
one coming
minutes.
Up.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to do two more questions.
We're in corporate finance, actually.
Two more questions. You're one of them?
Yes. Thank you. Hi, thank you so much for the very insightful discussion. Here's my question. You know, for the past 10 years, I worked with the Open Society Foundations of George Soros. And I'm not trying to defend it. I'm not saying, like, you know, I'm not there for some reasons. But I've been doing, for those past 10 years, I've been giving grants to human rights lawyers, going to UN and courts and defending rights of people who nobody really cares about. And I feel the change that we all want to see, there are always like losers and winners, right? Like it's very easy to bring all of us who look exactly alike to the streets. But when it goes to people who are trans or sex workers or LGBTQ communities in Russia, or I don't know, like people who nobody really likes, I feel it takes more than just activism of concerned citizens. I think it also takes I don't want to use the word professional activists, but activists who have the necessary knowledge and connections and networks in order to bring those relationships up front. And this is a lot of work. And so I do think that philanthropy is problematic for so many ways and for so many reasons. But then my question is, like, how can we make sure that that work happens? Because it can also, like, because those activists and human rights lawyers, they also need to pay their rent and put food on the table. And so this is the issue that I've been struggling with as somebody who made a career in philanthropy.
Anand.
First of all, you're going to love my Soros chapter about some of your colleagues.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, in a weird, like you look forward to the dentist. I think you're the issue you're raising is an important one, which is, you know, I personally believe, as you've heard, that many fewer things should be funded by philanthropy than currently are. I do not think the issues you're talking about should be funded by philanthropy. They should be funded by system change. Mm-hmm. That said, I think you're raising one area where there's a very strong case for philanthropy, which is counter-majoritarian minority interests that are actually, even in a well-functioning democracy, are not going to be protected, right? That's one of the two or three best use. I think the arts is another. I don't think you want the government funding all the arts. And then I think the third is experiments, right? You want to try something with universal basic income. Do not impose it on 300 million people overnight. Try it philanthropically in a couple places, see if it works, and you know. So I think yes, human rights is an area, but you can still take money from rich people in a way that does not give them greenwashing because you don't put their name on it. You can still take that money and have standards for not taking it from people like Jeffrey Epstein. You can still take money for those kinds of causes and not necessarily have a tax deduction, so people in our societies are paying billions of dollars a year in extra taxes to subsidize rich people giving to your cause. Your cause is important, don't worry, we're not coming for it, but there's still ways to structure it so that it is not part of enabling plutocracy.
Cool, thanks. We're gonna move to the last question. Yeah, sorry for that, but okay. It's getting to the end of the evening, and you've been standing up with your hand for quite a while. What is your name and question?
Hi, I'm Mark. My question is, I think you're all talking about system change. Yeah. And I think we're actually in the midst of a struggle of those systems changing. And at least I feel like I'm in the middle of it in a way where I feel like I've let go of this rock, which I knew, and I knew the terrain, and I'm falling down, and I'm, you know, I didn't get hold of the next rock still, in a way. And I do feel that in order for that system to change, even you, Anand, I've heard you advertise your book throughout this whole talk for numerous times, and that's not to blame you, but that is...
No blame taken.
That is this rock. Still in a way. So how do we get, not painless because it's going to take sacrifices, but how do we get to experiment to the next rock without falling down?
Well, new value. So if we would be able to capture natural capital, social capital, human capital, in non-monetary terms, if we could just value it for what it is, if we could just value nature for the fact it's nature rather than just exploiting it and putting it into money, I think we will get a long way with that new rock. It's my humble opinion, but.
Another addition?
I always love guys who come to book events and then complain that they're book events. but we wouldn't be men if we didn't do stuff like that. Look, I think I like the rock metaphor. I think it actually applies to many of the problems we've talked about tonight on the panel, but before the panel. I think, let's pick three, the environmental thing, I think the challenge around gender that we've been talking about in our cultures for the last few years, the conversation about wealth inequality. I think all three of those are issues of an old system dying and a new one not being obvious yet. And I think part of the problem for all of these movements, I think we haven't, if there's of course failures of these old regimes, but if there's a failure among those of us who are wanting to be in the new one, it's that I don't know that we have succeeded on the environment, on gender, on plutocracy, of conjuring, of showing people that the new world we want them to walk into is more exciting, mm-hmm. more thrilling. It's safe for them. You know, if you take the gender thing, it's in the world I live in Brooklyn, New York, people are fine with it. You go to the middle of Ohio with 60-year-old white guys, you know, yes, they're stuck in the past. That's true. But also, we have failed to teach them that they're going to be okay, and show them the vision, and show them that it's an okay world when your wife goes to work or that women run your country. You're not going to die. It's our responsibility to actually show that. I think on the environmental issue, the people who want to tell you that these people like you are trying to take away your car, have done a lot better job playing to the emotions of like what the world's gonna be like when your car is gone than the environmental side has done of showing like how fucking cool the world's gonna be when it's not organized around ego anymore. And I think we gotta start painting that new rock. Mm.
Thanks a lot. Marjan Spier, Kees Klamp, Linda Moerland en Anand Giridharadas. Thanks a lot for having this panel.
Thank you.
Any other pressing questions, just get to them at the bar or at the book signing. On a book event, we have also the signing of books. So,
we can be first.
Yes, you can be first, yeah. I'm interested if we would be first, but we'll see. It's just outside to the left. There you can get a copy of the book. This book by Anand. If you want a signature, you can also get a signature. And Anand, what's the Dutch title of this book?
Oh, let me do this. Waarom de superrooken de ver- I'm doing well, right? De Vereld niet zullen veranderen. I think the last part means sad balcony.
Thanks for being here at De Zwijger. Downstairs there are drinks and good evening. Thanks.
It is there, I still